All right, so now that we learned about this automatic learning rate finding procedure, let's actually try it out in practice.
So in this notebook, we are going to use the exact same code we used in unit 6.1. So we will have a few modifications, but I will show you exactly what these modifications are. All the rest is exactly the same code. So first we will start, of course, with watermark, then by importing some utilities, our CSV logger, the custom data module, the lightning model and PyTorch multilayer perception that we have in our utilities file. And here we are instantiating the multilayer perceptron as well as the lightning model. There's nothing new here, exactly the same code we used before. However, for this notebook, please make sure you're using Lightning 2.0 or larger, because previously Lightning had a different function for the automatic learning rate finder. Now there is this tuner, which is more powerful and can handle different, let's say, functions, as we will discover later also in this class. So if for some reason the following code that I'm going to show you now doesn't work, please double check that you're using Lightning 2.0 or larger. With this disclaimer, let me show you how we now find good learning rates automatically. So there is this tuner submodule in lightning.pytorch, and from there we are importing the tuner class. So maybe taking a step back, this is the trainer we already specified or used in unit 6.1. This is the same code, except that now we are adding this tuner here, and the tuner wraps around the trainer. So the tuner has certain functions. We will cover a few more later in this course. Here specifically, we are interested in the learning rate find method, which will find a good learning rate for our lightning model using the data module that we set up. So we are defining here the learning rate finder, and then let's actually run this and find a good learning rate for our model here on this particular data set. So this should be relatively quick usually, so this cell already finished executing. So let us now double check what the learning rate that was suggested is. So we can already see it's here. It's 0.109, which is very similar to our initial guess. So I must admit that I really randomly put in this learning rate. It's really an arbitrary choice, and it's kind of funny that the suggested learning rate is very close. So in this case, it might be already a pretty good learning rate that I guessed here correctly. But this guess comes with a lot of, let's say, domain knowledge. So this was a coincidence here. So let's actually, in addition, visualize the learning rate. So what I usually like to do when I use the automatic learning rate finder is visualizing the range that the learning rate finding algorithm explored, and then also showing me the suggested learning rate on that plot. So based on this plot, we can see, as we discussed on the slides, that we have the loss and then here the learning rate for different values, and the suggested learning rate is this red dot here, and you can see it's around 0.1 in this case. If you are running a script, for example, and you don't see this output here, because it's usually printed to the warnings command line. The red boxes are usually notifications that not always, let's say, show up on your terminal, depending on how you configure your scripts or terminal. So we can explicitly get the suggested learning rate by using the LR finder point or dot suggestion method. So let me show you what I mean by that. So we can use dot suggestion here, and then we get this learning rate that I'm printing out here just for reference. And you can see it's around 0.109. So that's our automatically found learning rate. So with that, let's actually use that updated learning rate. So we are going to overwrite the learning rate now in our lightning model. And the particular way we set up our lightning model is that we have this learning rate argument here that we use further below here when I have self.learningRate. That's just the specific way I defined it. You may define it differently, for example, using the hyperparameters function in Lightning. So that might be an interesting topic for discussion in the forum. If you're interested, I'm happy to discuss this more. But it just so happens that I set up my Lightning model like this, that I have self.learningRate. And here in this self.learningRate, then I'm assigning the new learning rate. So let's do that. Let's assign the new learning rate. And then using this new learning rate, let's train our model. So we are using trainer.fit like before, same thing as in unit 6.1. So I'm running this now, and this might take a while. Can already see though that the validation set accuracy is improving, which is pretty nice. So it seems like it is training successfully so far with this learning rate. So let's wait a few moments until we reach epoch 100 and can evaluate the results. So now that the model finished training, let's visualize the results. So I'm just copy and pasting the plotting code that I used before. So here we are visualizing the loss in accuracy. And yeah, as we can see, the training loss goes down, which is nice, but at some point also the validation set loss goes up, which indicates overfitting. So looking at the training accuracy, we can see the same thing here. Training accuracy improves. The validation accuracy hovers around a certain value, maybe around 87%. And we can see then that the gap increases, which increases essentially the degree of overfitting. In this particular unit or lecture, we won't cover how we can address overfitting. We will actually come back to that later. So for now, the goal was just to find a good learning rate. And later on in future videos, we will also address this gap here, the overfitting. But yeah, so we can see this is actually a pretty good learning rate. So let's actually also visualize the test set results. So in this case, they are 86.5, which is actually pretty decent. Let's actually save that number. So this would be for our suggested learning rate. And coming back to our learning rate plot. So when you look at this, you might hypothesize, we have a lower loss here. Maybe a lower learning rate might be better. So let's actually choose a lower learning rate. So this here is around 10 to the power of minus 8. So let's use a smaller learning rate maybe and see what happens. So let's just plug in 10 power of minus 8 here and run the same code, see if this might perform better. Yeah, and while we are training, we can see that there is no change in the validation set accuracy and training set accuracies, which is not a good sign. So this is usually an indicator that the learning rate is too small and the model is not really learning anything useful because these numbers don't really change. So there's something here where maybe the learning rate is so small that there is no improvement at all. So at this point, it might also be a good idea to show the training loss instead of the validation loss so that we can also see the validation loss changing at least, because that is usually true. The validation loss always changes. So we could technically enable that if you want to with proc bar equals to true here. So if you enable that, training loss will also be included in the progress bar. So we will see that then next when we run this notebook again. Okay, so the training has finished. Let's take a look at the plots. And yeah, we can see the training loss fluctuates around a certain value. The validation loss doesn't change at all. And the same is true for the validation. So the same is also true for the validation set accuracy and to some extent also the training accuracy, which becomes even worse over time. So in this case, our model is not really learning anything useful. So a learning rate of 10 to the power of minus 8, and this was a very small learning rate and it was way too small for learning. Now another question might be, what happens if we slightly increase our learning rate? So going from 0.1 to maybe 0.2 here. So increasing the learning rate slightly, because here it looks like, that might also be a better learning rate if we go a little bit larger. So let's try that out. And let's use a slightly larger learning rate. So this would be a learning rate that is about twice as large as the suggested one. So let's run this code again and see what happens. So now we can see there are changes. You can see that the validation set loss goes down here, which is nice. And the validation set accuracy goes up to some extent. Now we can actually see it goes down, which it fluctuates. Maybe there is some overfitting going on here. We will see once the training has completed. So it seems to be fluctuating a lot here. Okay, so the training has finished. Let's take a look at the results. What we can see here is that the training loss goes down, but then at some point it goes back up again. And the same is true for the validation set loss. So what is going on here? So I would say this is an indicator that our learning rate is now slightly too large. So what happens is that, yeah, our model, we can see, becomes worse over time because the learning rate is just too large. So this is not a good learning rate. Actually, we will learn soon in the learning rate scheduler part how we can address these issues. But so far, based on our analysis here, it seems like the suggested learning rate of 0.1 seems to be pretty decent. So before we had 86.5% accuracy with the suggested learning rate, then we had about 40% accuracy with the learning rate where the model was not learning anything at all. Now we have 67% test accuracy. So I would say the winner is the suggested learning rate. So in the next videos, we will then also cover how we can use learning rate schedulers to improve upon learning rates even further.
Yeah, so in this video, we talked about the automatic learning rate finding procedure, which can make our life simpler. In the upcoming videos, we will talk about another concept related to learning rates, namely learning rate schedulers.